More now on President Trump's latest comments. Let's bring on our political panel. Charlie Kirk founded Turning Point USA, a group for students interested in conservative politics. And Atima Omara is a Democratic strategist and former president of Young Democrats of America. Welcome to you both. Happy New Year to you both. This was a 30-minute interview with the president. There's a lot of highlights. We want to get to as many as we can. First, on whether his attorney general, Jeff Sessions, was disloyal by recusing himself from the Russia probe. The president said, I don't want to get into loyalty, but I will tell you that, I will say this, Holder protected President Obama, totally protected him. When you look at the IRS scandal, when you look at the guns for whatever, when you look at all of the tremendous real problems they had, not made up problems like Russian collusion, these were real problems. When you look at the things that they did and Holder protected the president, and I have great respect for that, I'll be honest, I have great respect for that. Charlie, was this a slam at Sessions?
Maybe slightly, but I will say this. If you look at the ethics that Sessions is conducting himself with versus Holder, it's actually quite admirable. Sessions did not have to recuse himself with this Russia investigation. In fact, I think it was a mistake. I think if Sessions actually didn't recuse himself, this investigation might have been stopped even quicker. But with that being said, you look at what Holder did under President Obama. I think President Trump is exactly right here. He covered up scandal after scandal, IRS, Fast and Furious, just to name a couple. And look, Sessions has been, you know, conducting himself with high ethical standards, and you can't say the same for the previous attorney general, both Holder and Lynch after.
Let's get Atima's reaction to that quote.
Here's what I have to say about this. I think that Sessions absolutely had to recuse himself because of him also being tied to having met with Kislyak and other Russian operatives. So it basically couldn't, you know, put him in a very bad situation. And so he had to recuse himself. That being said, I think we're getting confused protecting, you know, the president versus actually enacting an agenda. Holder enacted the agenda of President Obama. In this case, we're talking about Sessions recusing himself so that there is a clear way to do an investigation into something that the administration could potentially be implicated in, which is Russia's collusion with, you know, to get into the elections.
Let's get to the quote on the Alabama Senate race and Roy Moore. The president said, I feel that I have to endorse Republicans as the head of the party, so I endorsed him. It became a much closer race because of my endorsement. People don't say that. They say, oh, Donald Trump lost. I didn't lose. I brought him up a lot. He was not the candidate that I thought was going to win. So, Charlie, your reaction?
Well, you have to remember, President Trump endorsed Luther Strange, actually, in the primary, and that was his first choice. Roy Moore was an unbelievably flawed candidate. And, you know, if he would have won, we would have been dealing with having the media label him as the quote-unquote spokesperson of the Republican Party. But you look at President Trump, he actually brought up the numbers. I mean, Roy Moore was down almost 12 points 5 days before the election, and he lost by about 20,000 votes on Election Day. But we have to pick better candidates coming into 2018. We just can't have candidates that are the most, you know, possibly conservative person we can find. And if we're going to do really well in the midterms, we need candidates that can appeal to the entire populace, not just the GOP base in a primary.
Atima, I actually want you to weigh in on the next quote, which is about the president working with Democrats next year. He says that he thinks it can happen, and he says, in my opinion, they should come to me on infrastructure. They should come to me, which they have come to me on DACA. We are working. We're trying to do something about it, and they should definitely come to me on health care because we can do bipartisan health care. We can do bipartisan infrastructure, and we can do bipartisan DACA. Is this a pipe dream? Can he work with the Democrats, and will the Democrats work with him?
I mean, they have had attempts to work together that have actually seemed to be somewhat successful, such as the last-minute budget fixes and slowing down of the government shutdown. I think, obviously, going forward, it would be in the best interest of the country to work together on things like infrastructure. But on health care, there has just, whether, you know, the Republicans and the Democrats in the Senate have both made attempts to sort of work together. But then, you know, Trump signed an executive order that, you know, repealed some subsidies on health care. And also there was the individual mandate striking within the GOP tax bill. So it's sort of a little give and take. It's like he wants it, but then he goes ahead and doesn't do it. Well, so I think it would be in the best interest of the country, obviously, moving forward.
I agree. I wonder if Charlie agrees. It's obviously a big year.
Yeah, here's what I can't understand. You know, Heidi Heitkamp, Manchin in West Virginia, Claire McCaskill, Tester in Montana. They're not going to be able to do well in November in these deep red states if they don't get on board with the president's agenda. You know, the tax bill, I believe, was a terrific bill for the country. I can't understand, you know, why Joe Manchin, who, by the way, in West Virginia has the biggest GDP growth of any state in the country, thanks to the end of the war on coal, why Joe Manchin is not doing everything he possibly can to embrace the president. But you know what? I have no problem with it. I have no problem to get rid of all these red state Democrats. It's going to be in their best interest to work on infrastructure, but they are so controlled by Chuck Schumer and the radicals in the Democratic Party. I don't see it happening anytime soon.
The president,
and that
actually
just means Republicans will win more seats.
The president had one choice word for Senator Manchin that we cannot repeat here. Another quote from the president on the media and the 2020 race. He said, "We're going to win another 4 years for a lot of reasons, most importantly because our country is starting to do well again and we're being respected again. But another reason that I'm going to win another 4 years is because newspapers, television, all forms of media will tank if I'm not there, because without me, their ratings are going down the tubes. Without me, the New York Times will indeed be not the failing New York Times, but the failed New York Times." So they basically have to let me win, he said.
That. I don't know about that. I think you all do a good job without him otherwise and have good ratings otherwise. But I do think it's interesting that he's saying, you know, looking at 2020 and not 2018. I mean, look, Democrats played in races that, quite honestly, we had no business playing in. I mean, it was a 30-point swing for Democrats in Alabama. In Virginia, I'm a Virginia Democrat. We run up the score about 20 points and almost split the House, which was with an impossible map, picked up 15 seats. We're going into election years in states, battling out in places that we really shouldn't be and really shouldn't be competitive. We're even like polling ahead in Mississippi for the Democratic governor's race there. So, you know, I'm a little skeptical about things politically in the landscape going into 18, and he shouldn't really be talking about 20. He should be worried about keeping his majority in 18.
Well, people certainly doubted him in 2016, Charlie, and he surprised a lot of folks.
That's right.
It's hard to argue that he's not good for ratings.
Well, right. He's really good for ratings. I mean, from what I understand, the New York Times subscription numbers are way up, so he's not wrong there. But, you know, going into 18 and 20, you know, there's this narrative that's built that Trump somehow lost politically. Well, he was 5-0 in special elections where he endorsed early and often. You look at the big, what was supposed to be the bellwether race to the country, which was in northern Atlanta, which was Congresswoman Handel's race. She actually won that race by more votes than even Price did back 8 or 9 months earlier. So the president, when he was on referendum this last year, did rather well, Alabama being the outlier, because it was a horribly flawed candidate, someone he did not endorse in the primary. And going into 18, the Democrats have a very, very difficult map.
Okay.
They have to win in states such as Missouri, Indiana, Montana, North Dakota, and West Virginia. Very, very difficult.
I'm going to ask for quick reactions on this final quote. On the tax bill, the president said Democrats could have gotten a better deal had they come to me and said, look, we'll do this. We'll do something. I could have done something with SALT or made it less severe, but they were very ineffective. They were very, very ineffective. You understand what I mean? Had they come to me for a bipartisan tax bill, I would have gone to Mitch and I would have gone to the other Republicans, and we could have worked something out bipartisan. And that could have been either a change of SALT or a knockout of SALT. He's saying if the Democrats came to him, Atima,
You know what? Like, I'm not sure if he means him or if he means Mitch McConnell. They had put a letter together about the things that they wanted, not highest tax, tax cuts for the wealthiest and cuts for Medicaid and Medicare. And that's exactly what these two bills, what this bill is actually doing, is benefiting the most wealthy Americans. So, you know, we have tried to move forward.
Charlie?
No, that's just not true. It's the largest middle-class tax cut in America's history. It doubles the standard deduction. It doubles the child tax credit. Democrats would have supported this if President Obama introduced this bill.
Yeah.
Not only that, we're going to see an explosion of economic growth. It was a huge middle-class tax cut.
I think you two will agree to disagree in 2018 as well. Thanks very much for being with us on this
Thank
Friday.
You.